Today I want to talk about one of the coolest species of rat snakes from Southeast Asia, and that is the cave-dwelling rat snake, or the Ridley's rat snake. Now these guys are found in typically parts of Southeast Asia, usually found in Thailand along that peninsular part into Malaysia. Now these guys are really cool. Their actual whole species name is Othriophis taeniurus Ridleyi, and I probably butchered the actual species name, so as usual, as I just stutter over that, this is how this is going to go, I guess. Here's the actual Latin name for that. So the actual genus is called Othriophis. That is the full genus of mostly of all of the beauty rat snakes. Now they used to be part of the genus Elaphe. Almost all rat snakes across the entire world, including the New World North American rat snakes, were all part of the genus Elaphe. And then they broke it up to basically separate Old World and New World. Old World with the rat snakes like the king rats, the beauty snakes, and even the mandarin rat snakes were all Elaphe. And then the North American like corn snakes, Everglade rats, black and gray rats were all Pantherophis. And then since then, they've broken it down even more so. So the beauty snakes were one of, I believe, the last ones to have their genus reclassified, Othriophis. And then the species that Tenura, that I probably mispronounced, that is the species that consists of most of the beauty snakes. And then Ridleyi, the subspecies, the one that we're talking about today, is named after a biologist whose last name was Ridley. That's how we get the Ridley's rat snake. Now the cave-dwelling part, which is one of their other several names like all rat snakes have, comes from a pretty self-explanatory reason, which is where they are found. These guys are almost exclusively found inside of caves. Now when we go and we look at this part of the world, in, you know, Thailand and Malaysia, it's very warm, it's very humid, but these cave systems where they are found in a very different sort of climate. So you'd have to go through the typical habitat of the usual rat snakes, like the, you know, the Vietnamese and the Taiwanese rat snakes. That's the type of habitat you would typically see. And then you get into these limestone bat-filled caves where you find the Ridleys or the Ridleyi cave-dwelling rat snake. Now, when you first look at this rat snake, it looks a little bit different than the other beauty snakes, and that's probably because of where it lives. So it's similar in body shape and size, you know, still very slender bodied, has that very, you know, pronounced and very distinguished, typical kind of like broad snouted head, you know, about 4.5 to 6 feet long or so, females being a little bit smaller, males being a little bit larger. So some of the other different subspecies of rat snakes, they can exceed 7-8 feet in length. So these guys might be a little bit smaller on average. But when you look at the actual snake, they look very different as far as the pattern goes. In fact, they're almost patternless, especially when compared to some of the other ones. And that's because of probably where they live. Now, the regular beauty snakes, they have that kind of cool diadem, triangular diamond pattern that helps break up the pattern of the snake in the jungle foliage that it lives in, hanging out in the branches, fairly arboreal, things like that. And the darker and lighter color helps aid in camouflage with light and shadow. And then the diadem pattern itself will break up the shape of the snake. When we look at the Ridleyi, we can see that it's very different. The front, the top part of its head, and I shouldn't say the top part, the whole head, is kind of a gray bluish color, which, and then it has the typical kind of like black eyeliner, like racing stripes along the side of the, from growing from the back of its eyes to the back of its head. And then the rest of its body is kind of this kind of creamish, yellowy white color all the way down to the tail to around about the vent area where it gets that kind of dark bluish gray again. And then running essentially along from the back of the neck all the way down to its tail is typically, but not always, a white kind of racing stripe that runs along its spine, the dorsal part of the snake. And that's probably because of, again, where it lives. So when we think about these limestone caves, there's not a lot of light and shadow. In fact, a lot of times, sometimes there's almost no light whatsoever. And so a lot of that, when we think about kind of how that looks, that limestone part, it's usually a lighter colored mineral. The rock walls that make up the cave systems are usually a little bit lighter. Now that can vary a little bit depending on exactly the different mineral and the chemical makeup of the rock faces, as well as the amount of like bat guano, because of how alkali it is. It can actually change the actual color of like the water, the rock, and they actually theorize that even some animals that live in those cave systems also get changed just because of living in those conditions, because of that high alkaline chemical makeup of bat guano. But usually it's probably a lighter kind of creamish off-white color, thus the actual main part of the body of the snake. And then, because they're, you know, there's not a lot of light, there's not a lot of, you know, branches and leaves or anything like that inside of a cave, they don't need all of that pattern to break up the shape of the snake. But then maybe that darker head and tail kind of help and aid in camouflage of light and shadow, to where even at the beginning of the cave system, where there is still a little bit of light before you go in deep enough, that kind of light, that dark and light shadow in and amongst the stalactites and stalagmites, they can actually blend in a little bit better, and also hiding into, like, sometimes, like, the crevices wall of those cave systems. So that's essentially why scientists theorize that they look the way they do. Now let's talk a little bit about their behavior. So these guys are definitely more crepuscular and nocturnal than a lot of their counterparts and other subspecies of the beauty snakes that are usually a little bit more diurnal, more crepuscular. These guys, they frequently feed on, you guessed it, the bats, so the little micro fruit bats and insectivore bats that live inside of these cave systems. So when we think about the behavior of bats that are nocturnal, so they get up shortly before dusk and then they leave the cave systems to go feed throughout the night. And then when they come back shortly before dawn, so basically all through the hours of darkness and just before and after, the bats return to the cave system. And that's typically when we see the rat snake, the Ridleyi, most active and feeding, is when they're flying in and out, or out in, there we go, of the mouth of the cave. So these guys have a great sense of smell. They do have fairly high acute levels of high level of visual acuity, but it's also, again, you have to think about how dark it is. So they definitely are very reactive. They're very sensitive to air movement and that very great, great sense of smell, which allows them to literally grab bats out of mid-air flight as they leave and come back through that cave entrance. They also have been found and documented that they have gone on during the middle of the day when the bats are roosting up in the tops of the caverns and grabbing bats that way. Although typically it's probably less of a risk for them to grab them during free flight when they're all just trying to get out or come back in, than versus going through a crowd of roosting bats where they could potentially risk, you know, reactions from the bats. So it's a really, really cool species of snake. And when you think about all these different things about having them in captivity, we want to try to emulate that a little bit. So number one, these guys are actually endangered and are listed as such. So the availability of them is it's a little bit more scarce than a lot of the other, like the Vietnamese or the Taiwanese beauty snakes. So you're not going to see them as often. In fact, a lot of times you'll even see them at a higher price tag, and even sometimes to the point where they're actually like DNA sexed. So that way you know you're getting actual pairs and the different things like that, because it's a little bit more of a priority for a lot of keepers. But when we want to think about keeping them, the similarities are, they're going to be kept very similar to a lot of the other rat snakes. Excuse me, still getting over a code. Throat's been bleh. But with that being said, you know, when we typically think of a beauty snake cage setup, we have to think about a semi-arboreal snake found in Southeast Asia. So a lot of height, plenty of humidity, and usually a lower basking spot. So not as high as, say, like a boa constrictor or a ball python or even some other colubrids that prefer a higher basking spot. So, you know, a 4 to 6 foot long snake is the adult Ridleyi. So we're thinking at least 4 to 6 feet long is bare minimum, probably 6 feet long, with instead of branches that you would see from a lot of the other beauty snakes, maybe something like rock walls that would be a little bit more beneficial to the Ridleyi. So, you know, a lot of those newer, and they seem to be getting more and more popular, kind of rock wall backgrounds that you can almost like kind of cut to fit. Some of the different products that I've seen out there that you can fit into most of your typical little PVC or melamine enclosures, that they can kind of cut. They have extra little flap on the ends that you can cut them down to fit in here just perfectly, that have those kind of built-in ledges. That might work very well for a Ridleyi snake, where kind of like the Brettles python versus the like Spilotes, which are the carpet pythons in Australia. They're both semi-arboreal, just like the different beauty snakes, but the carpet pythons seem to prefer a little bit more like branching and tree perching versus the rock walls and ledges like the Ridleyi do, where they're normally found. It's a little bit more rocky, and that's where they like to perch. Just like with the rat snakes, the Vietnamese blue beauties and the Taiwanese, they would probably prefer a little bit more of those branch versus like the rock ledges for perching with the Ridleyi. Now, the beauty snakes are typically more arboreal. They're active more during the day, not arboreal, more diurnal. and they're more active during the day, which means that they actually usually have a little bit of a higher basking spot than a lot of the other Asian rat snakes when we think of, like, say, the Mandarin rat snakes or the Japanese forest rat snakes, and definitely the bamboo rats. But these, the cave-dwelling rat snakes, probably need a little bit lower of a basking temp. Excuse me. And that's, again, because of where they live. It can get very hot in the areas where they live, over 95, 96, 99 degrees Fahrenheit, for everybody living in anywhere outside of the United States. This is it in Celsius. So it can get very hot, as well as it can get down into almost the 50s during the colder parts of the years. Inside of a cave system, that temperature stays much more consistent, to where there isn't, again, there sometimes, once you go in a couple hundred feet, there's almost no light, which is where sometimes these snakes have been found, with zero light found, as well as closer to the front. There is a complete and total drop of temperature from the outside, especially during the hottest parts of the year, and then it is significantly warmer during the coldest parts of the year, but it stays very consistent, and that's where the rat snakes are almost always found. They have been found sometimes just outside of caves, but usually still very close to a cave or a cave system. So when we think about setting that up, that means that they probably don't need a whole lot of light, but clearly they are still seeking it out in the wild. So very low levels of UVB, maybe over in one corner of the cage, might be good, and it might be very beneficial to them, as well as not necessarily as high as basking spots as you typically would use for a other species of beauty snake. So, you know, if you get a, you know, a 5-foot enclosure, so a 5x2x3, you have that really cool rock ledge, several other hides that they can get for, you know, extra basking, because it is difficult for really anywhere outside of a tropical climate to completely emulate that, you know, 70 to 80% humidity in the air. We can do pretty well and get it into the 60s, but, you know, additional misting and extra humid hides is very beneficial to them, both elevated and on the ground. Large water dish, plenty of places for them to climb and perch. And then maybe in like one corner, very off to the side, a very low level UVA, UVB light bulb. For instance, like a VivTech products bulb, the jungle cover, or the one of the other very low levels of one, just in the very corner of it, to where they can go and bask and seek that out. But for the most part, probably using ambient temperatures and ambient humidity as to emulate our best job to getting very similar to those cave systems where they would normally be found. This is one of my favorite species of rat snakes in general, and it's definitely my favorite of the beauty rat snakes. That's probably because it was the very first one I ever saw in person. It was at a zoo here in Colorado, and it was really cool, and I just thought it looked kind of weird, which is also probably why I'm a little bit attracted to it, because I do have a tendency to like those kind of a little bit oddball, or just something not quite fitting in the same, like kind of like checking off all the boxes. There's a couple that they don't check off. I kind of like those different species, not just with rat snakes or snakes in general, but with a lot of different things. I have a tendency to like those sort of species and things. So today, hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. As you saw, a lot of the video that took place today, actually all of the video for this video, was done at my good friends Braden Exotics. As you've seen with a lot of the other more recent species spotlight videos, that we were there doing a lot of filming with all of their really cool species, because they keep a different variety than I do, especially a lot of Southeast Asian and Indo-Pacific species that I do not. I keep a lot more North American colubrids and more African species than they do. So that's why they very generously let me do a lot of filming with a lot of their really cool species. And at some point, we need to make another trip back out there to film even more, because we're basically out of the different species that we did filming that day. So big, big thanks to Braden Exotics. Again, as soon as they get all their stuff figured out, I'll retroactively, for this video, as well as all of the other ones that they were so gracious enough to provide video for, I will link that down, so that way you can check out their really cool stuff to see what they have going on. So big, big thank you to them. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you guys want to go check out any of the other species spotlights that I talked about, or any of the other ones that don't have their really cool snakes, but have more of my really cool stuff. And not just snakes, there's also lizards and tortoises as well. Here's the whole playlist at the end of the video, like always for these species spot lists. If you click through that, helps my click-through rate, lets YouTube know that I exist, which really helps me out. If you guys do want to support me in any other ways, number one, absolutely thank you so much for watching this video as well as all of my other ones. If you want to check out my Patreon, which I have linked down below, there's a wide variety of rewards and patron levels. It really helps support me what I want to do and what I love to do, and what it finally took me a very long time to figure out, this is what I do want to do. So thank you so much. I mean, even if you don't, it does really help me out, but if you don't, that's perfectly fine. Just watching these videos absolutely helps me almost as much as well. I really, really appreciate it. Again, thank you so much for everyone watching this. Thank you again. Stay tuned for more reptile and other animal content. If you guys have any ideas or want to see me discuss anything, let me know down in the comments. You can always email me, jzsreptiles@gmail.com. That's also linked down below, like every other video. I don't know what's going to happen for October. I typically do, as I mentioned previously in another video, that I usually do in October, like kind of spooky special, but it doesn't ever really seem to do very well. In between both the onset of COVID and us moving and not having as much time or money to do so, I can't be traveling all over and doing shark dives and visiting wolves in Yellowstone this year, as I have for previous spooky videos. So if you want to see anything really cool discussed, let me know down below again. Sorry for the little ramble at the end. Just want to throw that out there. Keep everybody up to date, kind of what's going on. And we will check you next time.